Hey, brothers and sisters, I am back again. Hey, I'm getting ready to make some chicken. I'm going to smoke it on my smoker. I have a Pit Boss smoker that I've had for almost a year now. Wonderful thing. There's one of my little baby Charlotte. There's Charlotte. She has her mama's sock. Hi, Charlotte. And I had a rapture dream, or going to the supper dream, you know. The thing is, you know, a lot of people talk about, with the rapture, they're talking about the bride of Christ and things like this. And sometimes we forget that there's this thing, that there's a wedding. And there's people that are invited guests, and then there's the bride. The Bible talks about who the bride is. And there's invited guests, and they're invited to come to this wedding. And they eat at the dinner, right? So I had this rapture dream, and I believe it's really demonstrating of that. But what I want to talk about first is the very words of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. You know, so many people say they believe in God's word, and they say, you know, I believe God's word, and I trust God's word. And then when it comes to certain other things in God's word, because they can't understand it, or they don't agree with what it says, well, then they'll put that on the back burner, or say, oh, you're misinterpreting something, or, you know, something like that will happen and cause people, what it does is causes division. And Paul talked about that in a few times in the scripture. But what I want to talk to you about is this scripture in Mark. It's Mark 7 and 15. These are the words of Jesus Christ. There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him. But the things that come out of him, those are they that defile the man. So that's the words of Jesus Christ, and it's not only in the book of Mark, it's also in Matthew. But let's look it up here. And if I can find this in Mark. I want to read it to you in context here. Imagine that. There's nothing that can enter into you that can defile you, according to God. Jesus Christ was talking to the Pharisees and Sadducees, and he said, before Abraham was, I am. And the I am that spoke to Moses in the burning bush was God. So Jesus is saying that he's God. So God said this. Matthew 7, look here. Hang on. Let's see. 15. So, he was talking about the commandments and about things to do and not to do. And if you read chapter, he's reading chapter from verse 6, he's talking to them about them being hypocrites, these Pharisees and Sadducees, because they'd observed him eating without washing his hands first. And so his hands must have been dirty, according to them. And so he didn't wash first. And then he talked to them about this. And then he also says, at the end, he says, by your traditions, you make God's word of none effect. Because what he's talking about is the traditions of men, and a lot of the oral law and a lot of those laws that are in there. There's 613 total laws that the Jews had to comply with for salvation, they thought. Now, we know that God commanded Moses to bring down the Ten Commandments, and then Moses had certain things that he asked God in particular about, and those are listed in the Bible. I think it's in Leviticus. And because people would come to him and go, well, what about this circumstance and what about that circumstance? And so somebody's trying to call me. Anyway, sorry about that interruption. So this thing about washing their hands, they commanded to be done, but it was really just them. It was not from God himself that said that. Now, this thing where Jesus said this is recorded in one of the other Gospels also. It's recorded in Matthew. I think that's where it is. Let me see here if I can find that. I believe it's in Matthew. I don't remember which one exactly. But if you go to Bible Hub, you can look up the actual Greek words that were used to translate the scriptures into English, right? And so this word is exothen, which means from without. Nothing from outside of the body can defile you. You know, you may die, say you eat some milkweed or you eat some hemlock or something like that. It might kill you. You know, but it doesn't defile you. And if you go to this Bible Hub, you can look up the word defile. You can look all these words up. And then you can go and you can look at this Matthew Henry's and Paul's commentary and Gill's expository of it. And you can look at what Christians and educated men looked at these scriptures and they gave us what they meant. You know, because so many Christians were talking about the vaccine. Well, you're putting this into you and it's defiling your body and it's doing all this stuff. And so how does that reconcile with the Word of God? That's what I want to know from all these brainiacs that say all these things, you know, and they'll say, well, it's on, you can go to this channel that's not on YouTube. And it'll tell you, it'll show you all these videos. And when you look at that, it's a bunch of propaganda and garbage from all kinds of crazy people that are talking all kinds of crazy. And so, you know, the only thing that you can, what I found over my 50 years of trying to serve the Lord, or 60 years almost, I went forward when I was 5 years old. So I'll be 64 coming up here pretty soon. Well, what I found is that you cannot trust some man. You cannot trust these guys that are, that are saying a lot of this stuff because they have an agenda. They are trying to make a buck or get a click because that's how they earn their living. It's like when you see Perry Stone talking about his latest deal that he does with all the different pastors, and they talk about upcoming things in Bible prophecy and stuff like that. And then he asks for $65 at the end of it for the DVD collection. And $100 for the moving ones, you know. Maybe the CDs are $65 and they're $100 for the DVDs. But here's the thing. And people down him for that. But he's got an outreach and a ministry. And then he's trying to support himself. And, you know, we all lack in the area of faith when it comes to believing God's absolute word. Even I do. I have all kinds of problems. I had pneumonia in 2016. And that pneumonia, I was trusting the Lord. Pastor Patrick was praying for me. Numerous Christians were praying for me. And God didn't heal me for some reason. It almost killed me. If I wouldn't have went to the doctor, they said another 3 days, you would be in the hospital or dead. That's how serious that is. That's like, if you got your arm cut off at the elbow and somebody put a tourniquet on it and you don't go seek medical help, we know God can heal you. Perry Stone's dad had a story about some guy that got hit with a male arm off of a train and it split the guy all the way up his skin and he was dead, and they prayed for him and that man resurrected. But that doesn't happen every time. And so other Christians will attack people over their lack of faith or whatever. They'll say, well, you took the vaccine, so now you've defiled your body, you've done this, you've done that, and there's a little cross inside of everyone. And when you look at that, that doesn't go away whenever you become vaccinated, especially with the vaccine that I took, the Johnson & Johnson one. But, you know, somebody's going to attack another brother and sister on that. Just like when you get 65, you can, so many people at age 60, between 60 and 65 get pneumonia. And pneumonia kills thousands a year, right? And so they say, when you go to your doctor for your annual physical, he'll say, well, what's your age? Well, you're old enough now to get the Prevnar one that has, covers you against like 60 something different types of pneumonia, because there are variants in it. And I, back then I got a Prevnar 13, whatever it is. So anyway, I got the basic one, because that one is like $1,200 or $1,500. And my insurance wouldn't cover it at the time. When I turned 65, it will. And it's the same thing with teeth. You know, I, before COVID happened, I'd went into the dentist because I, one of my caps came off. And he's like, well, I don't have time to do this now, but we'll set you up. And he put, you know, and he's so busy, this guy is, that it was like 2 weeks in the future, it'll be okay, or 3 weeks in the future. Well, then COVID happened and they shut down everything and all the dental offices were closed. I couldn't go in there. And then finally that tooth broke, right? And so then I had to have an extraction. And now I'm missing a tooth over here because I couldn't get to the dentist in proper time to get my tooth taken care of. And so that happens to all of us. It's the same thing with these things right here. I can't see very good without them. And I haven't been able to see very good without them since I was like 20, 22 years old or 23. My eyes started having little problems. So when we read these commentaries, you know, every one of us go to doctors at various times, and we take aspirin or we take some other type of pharmaceuticals. If we get a cough, you get a sore throat. Say you get strep throat or something, you know. Of course the Lord can heal you. You know, and it's on you whether you want to pray for that, you know, and get healing. We know that the Bible doesn't say that absolutely every time everyone that prays for healing will be healed. It does not say that. It is not a guarantee. Like salvation is a guarantee. Salvation is a guarantee, and you can take that to the bank through faith that you will be saved because of the work of Christ on the cross. Now, if you get a busted arm or you're in a car accident, you're hurt really bad and you're bleeding, you're going to refuse medical treatment by the EMS team that comes out there? Or like the guy that crashed that I was there and he burns to death underneath the vehicle because I didn't have a rope to be able to pull him out of there. And I had to watch that man burn to death and watch his fiance stand there and cry as we watched him die. You know, if I would have had a rope that day, I could have got that guy out of there. I tried to get him out. I grabbed him by his shirt, and his shirt melted off in my hands. Gasoline was around both sides of him. It was squirting out of the gas tank. It had a pinhole in it, and it was going onto the crack of his butt. And it was going all around him, and it was all around me. And there was junk everywhere, and it was all on fire. How many people do you know would run into a fire like I did to try to save someone's life? Okay? And I didn't go to the newspaper when the highway patrol said, hey, you want your name in the paper for what you did? No. Why? I said, because I didn't do anything. I failed. The guy died. And then we found out that the vehicle was laying on top of the guy. On his legs, I couldn't see it because of all the junk that they were moving that had flew out of the back of the pickup truck onto him. And then when I ran back to my car to get something to pull the guy out with, I thought, well, maybe I have a rope in there. And the rear tire exploded and blew gasoline forward and all up the hillside, set the hill on fire. It was horrible. And unless you've ever lived that, you don't know what it's like to see somebody die and you're trying to save their life and they die. So Matthew Henry, he says, our wicked thoughts and afflictions, words and actions defile us, and these only, as a corrupt fountain sends forth corrupt streams, so does a corrupt heart send forth corrupt reasonings, corrupt appetites and passions, and all the wicked words and actions that come from them. You see, and this is over and over again in this stuff. If you just go and look at this and really dig into it. You know, somebody sent me some deal and I go onto this site. And all it is crazy people talking crazy stuff that's unprovable. And most of it's about just nonsense. And Christians are posting there because they think that they can't post it on YouTube because YouTube is going to knock it down. As soon as they see you say anything that's not true or not scientifically accepted, they will take it down. That happened to me because I was talking about it doing something to your DNA or something. I mentioned something. They just pulled my video down. And because it goes into the RMA, and that's where it does its work, and it causes your RMA to build the spike protein, and then your body sees that as an invader, and then it rejects it, right? It attacks it. Just like if you got a splinter in your finger, it would fester under there, and pretty soon there would become pus buildup, and then it would expel that splinter most of the times out of your body. God built us with all these natural defenses that are inside of us to protect us. He made all of the herbs of the earth for our use, to help mankind. We are living in a fallen world right now. When Adam and Eve sinned, there was a perfect world that they were supposed to live in. And then the world that came into being after the curse, because God cursed the world after Adam and Eve sinned. And then he kicked them out of the garden and put two angels there to guard the way to it so nobody could go back in. You know, what really bothers me is the ignorance of some people and the judgmental thing that they do to others through attacks on their personal character and whatever else. When the Bible clearly teaches, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, said, nothing going into you can defile you as far as God is looking at you as a Christian. But then there are those, there's a guy that's a minister that says, well, that destroys your DNA, brother, and it causes those crosses to break, so you are defiled before the Lord. It's terrible. You know, and he talks about, Jesus talked about this little one that he put on his lap, and he's not just talking about a child. He's talking about people that love the Lord and are innocent, and then somebody else, an adult, somebody else that doesn't agree with them, attacks them. So, if you read that in English, it says nothing. This is what the Greek word says. Nothing there is from outside the man entering into can harm him or defile him. So, this same word is used in Revelations. It's used in a bunch of different places. It's used in Matthew 23:28, Matthew 23:27. It's used in Mark 7:15. It's used in Mark 7:18. So, you know, Jesus talked about the outside of the cup being clean and the inside's filthy. You know, it's that people, it's like all this stuff about trying to keep these Jewish holidays and laws and stuff and don't eat pork and all these things. And Paul talked about people coming to spy out their freedom in Christ because they didn't keep the law. Read 2 Corinthians, the whole thing, and you'll see what Paul was talking about. So, let me see what else I have here. That word, it's E-I-S-P-O-R-E-U-O-M-A-I. Literally, to enter, to go inside. So, when you get an injection, the vaccine or whatever it is, vitamins or whatever they give you, goes into you. And the definition is to enter. literally, come in, came, entered, entering, enters, go, goes, moving about freely, went. And a property of a person with an accusative place. So he's talking about this person, this thing entering him, and it's an accusation that it defiles you, and that's wrong. It doesn't. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, said that, not me. It's like when he talked about marriage and divorce in chapter 5 of Matthew, and about how you're not supposed to divorce your wife unless it's for, unless she has committed some type of sexual sin against you. You can't divorce her because you don't. She's getting old, or she doesn't cook a dinner just the way you want her to, and all these kind of things that people do now. Well, we just don't get along, so we have to get a divorce. You know? He says whenever you do that, it causes your wife to sin when she remarries, and you also. You know? He's got a lot of stuff he says, and people don't want to listen to it, and they don't want to do it because they've already did the damage. Oh, I already did this. Now I'm going to go on from here. That's like this guy that stole this money, right? And he embezzled this money, and then he got saved, right? And then the guy says, well, I don't have to give it back because I'm saved now. In fact, that's how I make my living. I've done this my whole life. I'm going to do a little bit more, you know? And then in Matthew Paul's commentary, he says, the addition of these words, if any man having ears to hear, let him hear, confirm what I observed before, that the Savior looked upon what he said as truth and a very great moment. Do you see what I'm saying? These men are great men from the past, and people go to school to learn what these guys said and to study this stuff. And so we should take notice to this as Christians. You know, instead of using our own imaginations or our fears or our prejudices, you know, people do that. They'll get prejudice against somebody because of some idea they have. And their idea may be totally wrong. There's been, you don't know how many times in my hundreds of thousands of responses I've given to people over the past 10 years that somebody will say something to me and I prove them wrong. Like I'll send them a thing and say, no, this is what it is. This is what really the truth is. And this is where I get this from. And then they'll go, oh, okay. But they never say, I'm sorry. Very few people, there has been a few. I can't say never. There have been a few people that apologize, but most of them won't because of pride. You know, people are proud. And they'll say all these hurtful things to somebody, and then they don't want to apologize for it. They don't want to repent and humble themselves over what they did. They just want to keep going, you know. And it's the Bible Hub thing. That's the best thing. And you can go on there and you can click on you can see a verse. Say you want to look up this particular verse that I'm looking up. I type it in. I go to it, and then I can push commentary, and it will tell me the commentary on that particular verse. And then I can push on the original Greek words for that, and it will tell you the original Greek, what it says exactly. You can look at all the various words. You can look up each individual word separately and see the definitions for them by clicking on them. See? So you click on this word, it tells you the word, right? Which is nothing. So you look that up and it'll give you the Greek words for that, and it'll tell you where it's used other times in the scriptures, or say there is, like this one, it's 15:10. And then it will tell you the different times, or this word, exothen, which is there, is from the outside, the man entering into, and you can look all those things up and see what they actually mean for yourself. And you can look at it and go, wow, Jesus Christ was saying that there's nothing that comes that can go from outside of you, inside of you, that defiles you as far as God is concerned with salvation. It may kill you, like I said. It may do harm to your body. But it doesn't defile you and separate you from God. You know, people, it's like people talk about somebody drinking a glass of wine. And Jesus Christ drank wine almost every day. In fact, at the Last Supper, he gave wine to the apostles to drink. And then he told them, I won't drink it again until we're in the kingdom. And he drank it with them all the time. You know, water was dirty back then. And wine and things like that were cleaner as far as consumption goes. So let me talk to you real quick about this dream that I had. I was praying, you know, many of you guys know my wife and I have this disagreement, and she won't talk about God with me or Christianity or anything, but she'll tell me real quick that it's not God speaking to you. Like, when did you ever hear God speak to you? But he's not speaking to you. I know that. Even though he's never spoke to me, I know he's not speaking to you. Or whatever it is. So anyway, we've been going around and around in circles. But I was praying for her last night. And I want you guys to help me with this, if you would. You pray for my wife. But I was praying for her last night. And I went to bed. We went to bed, and it was pretty late. And we watched a little bit of TV and stuff, and she's got to get up early, but we stayed up late. And so it was like 9:30, 9:45, and then I finally was able to go to sleep. It might have been 10 o'clock when I finally went to sleep. And so I was praying for her. In fact, I took my Bible, and I slept with my Bible under my pillow last night, and I'm going to do that every night now, I think. So anyway, I have this dream, and I dream I'm with my son Abraham. And I've asked God, when Abraham's with me, God, how come he's in these dreams, you know? Like, what is he doing? And God spoke to me and told me that he's there because it's the promise. He represents a promise that if I say this, this is what's going to come to pass. And God had told me in the past that my wife is going to be saved. He told me that he loves her. Her name in the Greek, I mean, in the Hebrew, she has a Hebrew name, even though her parents didn't know they were naming her this. It means promised to God. And so God told me that he loves her and that he's going to save her. But right now, you know, it's very difficult in my life. It's very hard. So anyway, I'm with my son and his wife, and we're in like a bigger car, you know, like a Ford Explorer or something. And my two grandsons are back there in the back, and my son and my his wife. And we're going to this, we've been invited to this huge dinner, right? And we're going there, and my wife is following us in her car. And it's starting to get dark outside, starting to get late, and we're driving, and then I see her turn off down another road, you know? And I'm like, why did she do that? Why is she doing that, you know? And so I started to turn around, but then this thought came to me in the dream that, oh, there's another way to make it to the dinner. But it's a longer way, and it's harder to get there, and it takes more time, but you still get to the same place that you guys are going to. And so this thought told me that's what she's doing. She's going this way, and this is the way it's going to be, and she's going to get there, but it's going to be a harder road to go, and it's going to take longer, and she's not going to go the same way that you're going. So to me, that really speaks about the wedding dinner and all that. Like Brother Brian, OT for Jesus, before he died, he told me, Brother Gary, I had a dream, and I dreamed I was at the supper, the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he says, I was sitting at the table, and my dad was there with me. And he said, you know, my dad got saved just before he died. And he was there. I saw him. He was sitting right there at the head of the table with me. And he says, and then pretty soon, here came my mother. He says, my mother came in. and sat down beside me. He said, my mom's not even a Christian. And so then he says, my wife came in and my daughter. And then he says, one of my sisters came, and then my son came. But my other sister didn't come to the table. And he says, and we were waiting for Christ to come in there, and we were all going to eat together, and there were, you know, thousands of Christians there in these huge tables, and we were in heaven. And so after Brian dreamed that, he woke up and he called me to tell me about it. And I was like, well, are you sure that you know, did you have a rapture dream where you actually went? You know, because a lot of people will say, well, I had a rapture dream, but they don't actually go up. They may hear a trumpet or whatever, or some terrible things may happen, and they don't know, and they say, well, that was a rapture dream, and I just didn't get taken at the time, or I was going up and then it ended, or whatever. So I was concerned, because the Lord had told me that Brian was going to die. And I was talking to him about, and I was afraid to tell him the truth. Oh, Brian, God told me that you're going to die. I did tell him, look, when God spoke to me, we were talking on the phone, and God told me, as Brian was hanging up, within like a millisecond, I don't know how this is possible, but I heard all this stuff before he could hang his phone completely up. And I said, Brian, stop. And he's like, what, man? And I said, God just told me that you're going to be in a car accident, and it was like it's really bad. It was like you almost like you died. It's what the feeling got, like you died. And I said, I don't know, but that was just the feeling I got, brother. And I said, and they were getting ready to go to church. And I said, be careful. I said, don't change your route. I wouldn't do that, but I'd be very cognizant when you're driving of what's surrounding you, and, you know, obey the speed limit and all this stuff. I said, because that's how I felt, like you die. And I said, I don't know that you die, but it just had a feeling. And he knows about dreams and stuff. And he said, yeah, I understand. I said, don't tell your wife and your family, because you'll scare them. And if nothing happens, you know, but I really felt the presence of God, and I felt like it was God, but I was still afraid to tell him and push the point home, right? And so Brian, nothing happens. And like 2 or 3 weeks later, maybe 2 weeks later, he's pulling into his garage. His foot slipped off of the brake and went on the accelerator, and he went into the garage, hit his wife's car, and hit the back wall of the garage and buried the nose of the truck. It was a brand new pickup truck. He had into the garage, right? Wall. And so they had the truck for like 2 weeks or more, and we were talking, and Ryan's like, well, maybe that's what God was saying. You know, maybe that was the accident that you saw. And I was like, I don't know. It seemed like it was a lot worse than that, Brian. And so then he got his truck back, and he had him rotate the tires. And then he was driving it he drove it home, and then he was going to work. And he decided not to go on the freeway that day. He decided he was going to drive the surface streets. And he was going about 40-some miles an hour, and his rear tire came off. And the back end of the truck went down, and he spun out. And it didn't destroy his truck, but it damaged the brake drum and disc and all that stuff. And they had to have it back in to repair. It was their fault. They didn't tighten the lug nuts. And he's like, well, maybe that's what it was, you know, because I was going fast and it scared me. I thought I was going to get hurt, you know, because this truck was raised up because of the floods that were happening in Texas at the time, you know, and he didn't want to have, they almost got stuck in their house. And so it was raised like 3 or 4 inches taller than a normal pickup truck, maybe 6 inches. But anyway, so I was like, well, I don't know, you know. And then, okay, another week or two passed, maybe 3 weeks. And it was in November. November 27th. Brian called me in the morning. It was just after Thanksgiving. He called me, and I was getting a haircut, so I couldn't talk. But when he called me, the Lord spoke to me, and he said, Gary, Brian's fallen off the wagon. And to me, that meant he was drinking or something, you know? And so I was concerned, but he and I had had a little argument a few weeks earlier, and he didn't talk to me for like a week before this. And then he started talking to me again, and I didn't want to offend him. And God didn't say, Gary, tell Brian. I don't think he said that to me. He might have, and I didn't obey him. I don't know. But we'll have to wait to the instant replay when we get to heaven and see what he said to me. But anyway, he says, I got to go, and I was going to have, my wife was going to cut my hair. And so then I was going to tell him later what God had said to me. I was going to try to work it in there some way, gently. So that night I was talking to him, and I saw this thing about Spock, the guy that played Leonard Nimoy, the guy that plays Spock, and how he came up with the Vulcan sign for hello, which is really a Jewish sign for one of the letters in God's name. And so all these Trekkies, I thought it was kind of funny, all these Trekkies are saying God's name, you know, doing a Jewish symbol. And I'd sent that to him, and he was busy, and he didn't really understand, and I explained it to him. Finally, he laughed, said, I'll have to watch it, you know, and then I didn't, and he didn't call me. Well, that night, at 11:59, he got killed. He went out to do something. I never heard whether he had alcohol in his system, but there was a wine bottle. He was under a lot of stress, a huge amount of stress, and his back hurt, and he was doing all this stuff, and I think he was taking Tylenol with codeine, and he drank some wine. And he lost control, and he hit a Christmas tree, and he didn't have a seatbelt on, right? But he had airbags. The airbags came out, and he hit this tree. The tree was about 4 or 5 inches in diameter at the base, and it sheared it off. The truck kept going, and it hit a brick-lined concrete wall. Stopped him dead and killed Brother Brian, OT for Jesus, instantly. He killed him. And then the next day, I tried to text him. He didn't answer me. And then the next day, his niece calls me, texts me, and says, hey, Brian was involved in an accident, and he didn't make it. I'm like, I thought Brian was messing with me. I could never fathom that this man that had been so close to me, spent 5-6 years talking with him every day almost on the phone, he's dead now. And he was dead. It killed him. And I prayed about it. And I said, God, did Brian, was he drink? Did he go to hell or something, God? And I saw Brian in a fishing boat with all this messy tackle everywhere. And I was standing on the edge of the dock looking down at him. And he had a white line in his hand, like glowing white. And he says, come on, brother, get on board with me. And he was just laughing. And I woke up. I don't know what that means. I'm hoping it means he's in the kingdom of God. I don't think God would keep him out for having a drink and getting killed under the pressure he's under. You know, so many people want to judge everybody about things. But I love Brother Brian. And now his wife has no husband. So this is the 4th year now since he's been dead. You know, we only have a certain amount of time on earth, and we need to love one another, forgive one another. Jesus gave 2 commandments, that you love one another like he loved them. He said, love your neighbor as yourself. How does love work whenever it's attacking? Did Jesus attack anybody except for the ones that were religious of the day? Because he went to the house of one of the Pharisees, and a prostitute was sent there, and she cried on his feet and put perfume on his feet. She washed his feet with her hair. Jesus washed the feet of the disciples. You know, so many times we don't have any love. That's what I see. And especially people that call themselves ministers or preachers or prophets. A lot of them, you know, they tell a story about Wigglesworth, and he would punch people in the stomach. Say, cancer, get out of there, and punch them. I never read one time in the Bible where Jesus punched anybody. Some people would go through his line a second time because the first time they went there, they didn't get their healing. He'd say, get out of my line. Would Jesus do that? You know, Jesus Christ was the Son of God while he was on earth, and he did all these signs and wonders. He says, why? Why did I do them? As a sign to the religious of that day in the world that I am the Messiah. He was able to do these great miracles. He cursed a fig tree and it was dead the next day. He raised the dead. Somebody had been dead for 3 or 4 days. You know, if we can't love each other who we see, how are we ever going to love Christ? Anyway, that's what my rapture dream was. I really believe it was a rapture dream from the Lord about my wife getting there, but it's going to take longer and by a different way, which Amy and Abraham, I believe, are going to be taken in the rapture, and so are their children. And she may, I believe, unless a miracle takes place, my wife's going to go through the tribulation. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, my brothers and sisters, come before your mighty throne. Almighty God, we are so thankful that you provide for us a place to live and vehicle to drive and electricity to warm our houses and cook our meals with and gas to warm and cook. God, that you provide a place for us to take a warm shower and we can have a warm cup of coffee in the morning if we want one, Father, and we have food to eat. Almighty God, we ask that you'd undertake, glory to your name, that you'd undertake for the leaders of this nation, God, that you bring condemnation upon them, that they would repent of their sins. Father God, we ask that you'd undertake for the pastors across the United States and throughout the world that need your help and uplifting. We ask that the Holy Spirit would be sent to them in power. God, that the healing of the Holy Spirit would be evident in this world, God, and that you would do these mighty miracles that your Son did and the apostles did in the very beginning. Father God, we know that there's a great debate in the church. Even back then, if you research it, they were debating whether the miracles had left or whether they hadn't, whether healing was for then or whether it wasn't. God Almighty, there was always this churning of men trying to decide what was right and what was wrong. And we don't know, God, everything that we need to know. We ask for your help. We ask for your guidance through the Holy Spirit. We ask that if there are any out there that are listening that are unsaved, that they would get saved, that they would fall on their knees and repent of their sins and ask you to come and live in their hearts. And they would trust your Son for their salvation, because that's what it's about. Faith in your Son, that he died for us on the cross, an atonement for our sins. Father, we ask that you'd undertake, because Russia and China are both breathing threatenings against the United States of America. It's not on the news because they don't want to reveal this, because it makes Biden look even worse than he is. Father, we ask that you'd undertake, inflation's coming, this horrible thing, God, and people are going to be starving. Father, help us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we ask it. God Almighty, we ask that your blessing would be upon us, that you'd undertake for us. Father, that you'd give wisdom to these pastors, that you'd bless the work of their hands, God, that they might be able to bring in the lost, God. So many times they preach the same old gospels every Sunday. They don't talk about the lost. They don't have an outreach for the lost. And that's why your Son came. There's a difference between teaching of the church and the people that are in there and actual salvation, the message of salvation for those that are lost. That's what we need in this world. God, we ask that you'd stop the mouths of Joe Biden, Nancy Pelosi. God, all these people that seek to destroy and to harm, and they call themselves Christians. They say they're under the banner of Christ, but yet they want abortions to be from the time a child is conceived until the end, God. We ask that you'd help. Father, we ask that you'd undertake in the mighty name of Jesus Christ for those of us, God, that are here on earth, that you'd send your Son soon. Your word says to ask that you'd be, that your Son would be sent soon. We ask that he'd be sent soon. Father, we ask that you'd send your Son in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We ask this according to your word. Your word says, Jesus, your Son, said, if you ask anything in my name of the Father, he'll grant it. So we're asking Almighty God for help, for our nation and for the world, God. Russia has just deployed missile systems on the Pacific coast area. They've taken over some Japanese islands. It's not even on the regular news. They put up missile defense systems and ship-killing missiles on those islands, God, so that they can hit our aircraft carriers if they need to. The Chinese and the Russians have both been doing overflights. The Chinese have been overflighting the areas of Taiwan because they want that island back, given back to them, God. And that's where a lot of these microchips come from that we put in all the devices that we have, God. And the Russians have been flying ever closer to America. They're flying within our international water areas, God. We ask that you'd help us, Father God, that you'd protect us, that you'd put the fire of Christ in our hearts, God, that you'd put the hunger for the word, that you'd put a hunger for prayer in our lives, that we would seek you, God, in a humble way and find you, Father God. You said if we seek you, that we will find you. God, help us fulfill your word in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We pray and ask it. Amen.